Hello, Malty Magistrates. Thank you to Arc Streams for the malt mention, because that was a malt mention, because this is Ralfy Review 739, here in the Manx Bothy, all about whiskey, scotch, single malts. This one's called Port Charlotte, 10 years old, bottled at 50% volume. Very nice. In a chunky dark green bottle with sort of raised letters on it that says Port Charlotte, and it looks very nice. There you go, now you know. A little bit of departure from the usual Bruichladdy bottle, and I think it's to give more identity to the Port Charlotte version of Bruichladdy compared to the Bruichladdy version of Bruichladdy and the Auchtermore version of Bruichladdy. Bruichladdy is a distillery on Isla off the west coast of Scotland, home to peated whisky. Bruichladdy is not peated whisky, not all the time. Port Charlotte most definitely is, and Auchtermore tends to price itself and pitch itself in the wider market as being the most heavily peated whisky in the world. If you go by computer printouts from malting factories. But not if you're using your nose. Just sharing. Oh, very nice. Very accessible. It's not an almighty maelstrom of phenolic saltiness as you would get from Laphroaig, for example, or Young Lecheggs. This is quite a civil arrival in the nose. Sultana. Phenolic, yes. But a more of vegetal phenolic. Slight iodine notes. Slight hints of mint and menthol. And a little touch of licorice. Burnt licorice. Sour licorice on the nose. It's a lovely fireside dram. You know, it's a real winter whiskey that you would have after a day out in the hills and cold weather and probably a big shower of rain, and you're getting back to the fireside, and it's been an exhausting day and you want something that's really punchy, that's going to come out and slap you around the nose and the tongue. Well, this will do fine, absolutely fine. What I'm enjoying about my first experience of an age-stated Port Charlotte, because there already exists a Scottish barley version, and in fairness a 2011 Islay vintage version, which is technically an age statement, but this is the one with the most overt age statement, 10 years, simple as that. And I've been waiting a while for this. I have some passing acquaintance with Port Charlotte in the past, and I've a great deal of fondness for this particular style of Islay heavily peated single malt whiskey. I think it's got a lot of character. That's one thing that stands out. It's not like any other Islay single malt heavily peated whiskey. It's got a genuine distinctive character of its own, and that really shows on the nose and the taste. The taste, neat at 50%, is remarkably civil. Sure, it's intense, but it's actually quite sweet, slightly resinous, as if they've been maturing in ex-wine casks, fresh ones. Which might explain why the elemental nature of the peatiness is somewhat subdued, and rather than bottling at 46%, they've bottled at 50% to give this heavily peated whiskey some much needed punch to help build its reputation and get acceptance on the heavily peated whisky scene. Good move. It works. It really comes across as relatively young, no doubt about it. It's a young 10-year-old whisky. The arrival is pretty bold, but civil. It's not really kind of leaving your tongue tingling, so to speak. But I will add some water now. I'm adding about a teaspoonful of water. I don't have my teaspoon. I keep forgetting to bring my teaspoon to the Manx Bothy, but there's a teaspoon's worth from my recycled straw. I recycle plastic straws. I'm a very modern man, you know, maltmates. I would say about a teaspoon is really all you need. When you taste it neat, it's actually quite palatable. You get some slight menthol notes, amongst the peatiness. It's briny, maritime, vinous. It's slightly salty. It's got a lot of character, personality, definitely there. But the intensity is rather restrained. When you add a drop of water, it'll kind of open up the palate just a little bit, not that much, because it's still a relatively young whiskey for its age. The nose becomes a little more citrus, by the way, barley citrus. The palate, there's a bit more energy in the phenolic impact in the arrival. It's mintier, spearmint, apple mint, pineapple mint, sour apple, a little bit of that in there. Overbrewed tea, a little bit of Japanese green tea in there. Matcha tea, you get that incredible bitterness of it, so you get a real distinct bitter note in here. So not a single malt I would recommend for beginners. And certainly I wouldn't recommend this for starting your whiskey session. This is a finisher, this one. Definitely finisher and a fireside after a busy day out in the hills. The finish isn't that big. There's no sustainability through the development. The initial impact, arrival, hit of that peatiness on the tongue when you first taste it, it's big, it's bold, but it doesn't tend to hang around. It quickly wings its way down your throat and disappears. It doesn't leave a lot left behind, really. There's some strong tea notes, a little bit of jasmine, a little bit of carbolic, a little bit of iodine note and bringing around the palate. And it's really quite pleasant, but it is not a hanging about single malt. So in other words, the finish isn't that big. Certainly nothing compared to the arrival and the first part of the development. Let's have another taste before I give my malt mark. It's really is a malt. You get more if you just hold it in your tongue. Keep holding it in your tongue. A little bit of sour red cola in there. Some beautiful, almost vegetal notes that are not, strictly speaking, what you would associate with phenolic. But it is a convincing, perfectly passable, and affordably priced. Certainly in Britain it is. Single malt from Islay, at a time when heavily peated whisky is very fashionable, malt makes, this should do very well. What mark will I give it? I think I will give this... Nah, that's a bit mean. I was erring in the side of meanness there with my malt marks and malt makes. I'm going to up it one. 86 out of 100. It's a malt mark. Yes, it is. I'm Ralfy. I'm done and dusted here. If you pop back again in my Ralfy Review Extras, 739 extras, I shall be talking about how peat gets into single malt whiskey. How does it actually happen? Because you do hear some conflicting stories and some fine old folklore out there, which isn't quite authentic with the actuality, in my opinion. Just sharing. See you soon.